Here with us to deepen our discussion on the country's labor issues are Hussein Makarambon and Catherine Laws of the International Labor Organization in the Philippines. Hussein is National Project Coordinator for Integrated Program and Fair Recruitment, and Catherine Laws, the National Project Coordinator of the ASEAN Triangle Project on Migration. Good to have you with us both. Thank you so much for joining us. So there you heard it. We have enough jobs here, but not enough to fill those skilled jobs. How do we bridge the gap? Hussein, Kathy?
One thing we could do is actually develop good labor market information. So I think beyond the government interventions, we should be in dialogue with employers' organizations, and the employers are really the ones who could provide labor market trajectories, who could provide us information on what kind of jobs will be in demand in 2 years from now, 5 years from now. And with that kind of information, it is something that the ILO itself is very interested in developing with our partners, government, employers, and the workers. We could actually inform schools, even the job seekers on what kind of jobs will be in demand in the future. And this will give us the information to be able to address the skills mismatch.
So Hussein, what jobs are in demand over the next 5 years? I mean, the ILO is in close coordination with schools, the government here. What do we need?
Well, job security is central. It's very important. It's an important element to decent work for all. With Filipinos with different levels of skills, no, from high level to low skills. So we support Filipinos here in the Philippines and those who seek jobs abroad. And that's why the Fair Recruitment Project ensures that the workers, the potential migrant workers, are not put at a disadvantage.
What do you mean disadvantage? I mean, what is going on right now in the whole process? I mean, if the ILO, you know, hadn't yet come in, what have been the challenges?
Well, of course, there are several issues in the recruitment process, and we want to make sure that they are well aware of these issues so that they could avoid them. Also, for them to know that there are laws that could help them, you know, find the jobs that match their skills.
Which laws? I mean, is this the law of the work site where they're going to be placed at, CAF, or is it more of the laws here in the Philippines? And what needs to be done in order to address the gap?
When we're talking about overseas employment, and the Philippines is actually a big labor-sending country, I mean, overseas Filipino workers, or OFWs, are a large part of our labor landscape. So here we see a lot of Filipinos who are unable to find decent work opportunities, who go abroad and seek better employment. So as Hussein mentioned, there are some issues when it comes to the recruitment of workers that can lead them to situations of labor exploitation when they're in the country of destination. So the International Labor Organization is working very closely with the government and the employers' organizations and the private recruitment themselves to basically improve the recruitment mechanism. Part of that is really about educating the people about the safe and legal mechanisms for moving abroad. A lot of them prevents them from being victims of illegal recruitment, and a lot of them is really about being responsible also for themselves to go through these legal channels.
Where is it most rampant? I mean, we're all over the place in the world as workers, skilled workers and contractual workers. Where is it most rampant?
I wouldn't particularly pick certain countries as most rampant, because labor exploitation happens in all countries. But I could name perhaps certain types of work or sectors that are more vulnerable to labor exploitation. These include fishing, for example, domestic work, construction, for example, or agricultural sector workers. These are workers that are more vulnerable and more susceptible to exploitation. Also, because these are certain industries where labor inspection, monitoring about their decent working conditions, is very difficult. So I think there's a lot of effort, and the Philippines is making a lot of headway towards this, to educating them so we have pre-departure orientation seminars to these workers to train them. These are some of the red flags, you know, be careful, for example, of contract substitution. These are your rights. So I think we're doing a lot of efforts right now because education, I mean, knowing your rights and knowing what you can do in case you have complaints are essential to protecting the workers.
What efforts are being made now to the Middle East workers? I mean, the price of oil had fallen, and a lot of the oil companies there have closed or shut down. And a lot of them have become stranded. Some of them have come home. Others are still in the Middle East. How can we help the government address that?
Well, the international organizations now are helping the government. So the Philippine government went to Saudi Arabia 2 weeks ago to go there. And this is one of the things that we've supported. The ILO fully supports social dialogue. So we had supported the government's efforts to go there to speak to the workers themselves about the conditions. They also tried to speak to the employers about what are the realities, what were the challenges, why couldn't you pay some of the workers. And I understand they also spoke to the government officials of Saudi Arabia to try to see how they can help. So there are assistance programs now to provide them with some legal aid as well as repatriation to help the OFWs who want to come home.
But Hussein, isn't that where the problem lies? I mean, once they're repatriated, what did they do here? I mean, if there is indeed a job skills mismatch here, what opportunities await them, if any?
Well, that's why the ILO really works closely with the different line agencies, our partners in the Philippines, also with the trade unions and the employers, to know what the needs are and what interventions will have to be taken. You know? So migration is one thing that we're working on here in the Philippines, but we're also working with different LGUs, especially in training community members. So we have a whole range of interventions, particularly for helping Filipinos find jobs.
And in the shift to the new government, there is a push to end contractualization. What does the International Labor Organization do to help the government achieve that, to end ENDO?
The contractualization issue is something that we're looking at very closely. So we do support looking into this phenomenon and addressing some of the issues. There are legal and unacceptable forms of this contractualization, as we understand. But what we do fully support is that, again, social dialogue is very important to us. We would like to see the government actually speak to the workers' organizations, the workers' representative, but also the employers, and see what how to come up with practical, also implementable, enforceable policies. I mean, we have to look at this in a very practical way.
From your organization's point of view, what is the most practical way? They've given deadlines like the next 6 months, end it by 50%, 100% by next year. What can be done, Hussein? Well,
income security, I think, is very important to many of us. No? So it really boils down to the worker. If he or she thinks that it's viable to stay here, then, you know, there are programs that the government is implementing. But if he or she decides to move abroad and find employment opportunities there, then I think what ILO is doing is really to support the Philippines in terms of its migration policies and ensure that they are able to enjoy decent work here in the Philippines or abroad.
And abroad means not very far in the ASEAN region, because we have the ASEAN Economic Community, Kath. I mean, the ASEAN integration's come into full swing this year.
Yes.
What impact has it had on migration within the region, considering the huge demand? I mean, this is the fastest growing sub-region of Asia.
That's true.
In the world,
yeah,
in fact.
Yes. In fact, migration now is playing... is now a key issue in the ASEAN region, because ASEAN is composed of a lot of labor-sending countries. So we have the Philippines, but we also have like Indonesia, Cambodia, and all these other countries that are sending a lot of workers abroad. But at the same time, we have countries like Singapore and Malaysia, which are receiving also a lot of migrant workers. So there's a lot of debate now, negotiations, and how to improve the labor migration mechanisms in the region, because migration is a concern not just for one country, but for you to have the really effective programs, you have to have bilateral, multilateral agreements with these sending countries.
I hear there's a lot of paperwork, and that's the first hurdle.
Yes.
I mean, even before you get moved to a different work site.
And
what are you doing to address that?
Well, in terms of if we match it to what our discussion earlier, the ASEAN is actually negotiating for the recognition of skills. In fact, there's already mutual recognition arrangements in 8 highly skilled professions. So that's when it comes to doctors, dentists, nurses, accountants, surveyors, engineers, architects. So these are the highly skilled professions, which is already quite regulated as well in our country. And the ASEAN has created these mutual recognition arrangements to facilitate the movement, the freer movement of these people in the region.
And what sort of trend are we seeing? Is it an outflow away from the Philippines or an inflow? Because the fear is a lot of our professionals here will move somewhere else because it's better paying.
Right.
So there's a brain drain that might happen, or it could be happening as we speak.
Yep. I mean, we do see that brain drain is a reality in the Philippines. So the challenge now is really trying to attract talent as well to the country. And what we say now, there's brain drain, let's discuss brain gain. So how can we attract our construction workers, our doctors, to go back to the Philippines and work here? So we have to, again, identify the labor market demands, the potentials here, to be able to create an attractive working environment in the country.
So is that part of the global initiative, Hussein, that there is a brain gain? The cycle of the outflow has to happen first before the coming back takes place.
Well, the Fair Recruitment Initiative, which is my project, no, it's not just the outflow, but also the movement within the country. So we want to make sure that a business model for recruitment is in place, that workers, whether you're overseas or whether you're within the country, ensures that it works and that workers are not charged of fees and that their rights are protected. So I guess when we have brain gain, it also attracts them to work here in the Philippines, because the processes are regular, they're formal, and their rights are protected.
Very interesting, and thank you so much for all this discussion on the labor issues facing the country and outside it. Thank you, Catherine Laws and Hussein Makarambon of the International Labor Organization, joining us.